25 ऑलरेडी. Hello and welcome everyone to yet another session of School Synergy Workshop Series. We'll be starting in a few minutes. People are joining. Myself, I am Ruchi Kumar, working as Assistant Professor in Center for Education Innovation and Action Research at Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai. We're just waiting for people to join. They're still joining and we'll start in some time. Okay, so I think I'll start now. So I'm Ruchi Kumar, Assistant Professor at Center for Education Innovation and Action Research. And in this School Synergy Workshop series, our attempt is to build synergy between educators working at the university level and school teachers and practitioners working with students. And we basically discuss ideas which can be implemented in practice in classrooms and hands-on opportunities to exchange ideas about resources and about pedagogies which can be useful in teaching. And today we are fortunate to have my very good friend and colleague, Jeenat Rehman. I've been working with her for many years. And so today we are going to talk about geometric reasoning, and we will also perhaps show you a glimpse of geometric reasoning module that we have developed at our center and have also implemented in four different states of India in our initiative, Connected Learning Initiative. Jeenat Rehman has worked as research associate in CLICS Initiative in Center for Education Innovation and Action Research, and she has also pursuing PhD from Homi Bhabha Center for Science Education, TIFR. And her research interests are in the field of measurement, multiplicative thinking, proportional reasoning, spatial thinking, argumentation, geometry, fractions, gestures, and embodied cognition, physical and digital resources for learning. So she has got varied interest in mathematics education. She has also facilitated math education course for teachers and practitioners at different levels. So we are very happy to welcome you, Jeenat, in this School Synergy session. Over to you.
Hello. Yeah, good afternoon, everyone. So maybe now
I'll just stop sharing. So Jeenat, you can share your presentation now.
Is it visible to everyone?
Yes, it is.
Okay. So without delaying much, as Ruchi clearly said, right now I'm working as a consultant in CIR Center, and I'm also pursuing my PhD. Okay. So just to like inspire you in the beginning itself, why I have chosen this topic and why this topic is very relevant, because it covers major portion in school curriculum. I think some 30% of our school math curriculum is devoted to geometric reasoning, and it is one of the foundational topic in mathematics, which has significance in a lot of other mathematical concepts. And it has relevance even in our day-to-day life to appreciate different aesthetics in real world. Okay, so being such an important topic in mathematics, school mathematics, how do we approach this topic? So there is a very classic work by Van Hills, and they have proposed that there are different levels in which children learn geometry. And it's not that these levels are like age dependent. We have found that even students from ninth grade sometime are at a very lower level of geometric reasoning. Like they reason at level one, which is the visualization level of geometric reasoning. But with proper facilitation, with proper scaffolding, students or learner can be facilitated to move to higher levels of geometric reasoning. So this talk is all about that. Like how can we, first of all, we will engage with all these levels which have which are important in itself. And generally a learner passes through all these levels. And we will also then understand how can we facilitate children to engage with these higher levels of geometric reasoning. Okay, so the first level is the level of visualization. At this level, children recognizes shapes more as how it appears holistically. Like they will recognize a square or rectangle in terms of some visual prototypes they see in their real life. Like a square is something which look like a window, a rectangle is something which look like a door. All such visual prototypes they draw from their real life experiences. At this level, to some extent, they can draw and copy shapes, but what they lack is again recognizing shapes based on its properties. There are also examples like they may recognize a triangle with these visual prototypes like a mountain or maybe samosa or like some barfi. But the moment the shape is like turned upside down or it's very thin, so they won't be able to recognize these two shapes as triangle. A very important study that happened to prove the same thing is when EI did this study in some major cities in India, and that too in all the elite schools in India, and they have found that a majority of students chose this one, the third option, as the triangle, because it looks like a triangle or it fits with their visual prototypes, very less number of students actually, as you can see, only one third of students chose the last one, which is the correct answer, as the triangle. So they end up choosing the other two options. And their reasoning also again fall under the visualization level, where they many times they don't consider this as a triangle because it is very thin or the corners are not very visible. So all sort of these misconceptions they hold to kind of argue that why this one is not a triangle. So maybe I don't know if like. So does any teacher also or anyone wants to respond to this or react to this? Like, do they also have experienced something like this?
So what do you think, why students select this third option, and so less percentage of students have responded as the fourth option as a triangle? Would anybody like to unmute and speak about it?
Ma'am, may I say?
Yeah, sure.
Mostly when teachers are teaching geometry in class also, we are used to drawing, we always use a proportional triangle on board, that is either an equilateral or an isosceles triangle, and it is always the tip on top and the base down. So for any practices also, most of the teacher will always draw a triangle which has the apex up and base down. So when it is turned the other way, and if you can see the figure also, it looks like a scaling triangle. So they are not used to seeing this triangle so frequently.
Yeah. So ma'am had brought out a really important issue that are missing in our many times school curriculum textbook or in our pedagogy, that we don't introduce a lot of non-typical shapes, which may kind of allow a student or kind of force a student to like recognize a shape in terms of its properties rather just how it looks like. Okay, so then we move to the next level. So at the level of analysis, students are able to identify and describe a shape in terms of its property rather how it looks like in the level of visualization, a student may say a triangle is something which look like a barfi or a samosa or a mountain, but at this level they might be able to clearly describe that, not just how it looks like, but it has three sides, it has three vertices, three angles, all those descriptions they can give. They can also describe shapes as a class, that all such shapes which has like the opposite pairs, equal and parallel, can be rectangle or parallelogram, all such kind of things they at this level they can recognize. So there are some examples also, like they can understand that all the angles of a square are 90 degree, a rectangle has exactly two pairs of parallel sides. But again, at this level, they are not able to infer the necessary and sufficient properties for a class of shapes. And they also won't be able to recognize the relationship between two different classes of shapes, like understanding that a square is also a rectangle or some other properties like a rectangle is a parallelogram or things like that. So how can we facilitate this level of reasoning? So for that also, we have some activities which are there in the learner handbook. By the end of this session, I will show how we can access the handbooks. So there we have activities like this, where a student had to describe these shapes. So this will allow students to move beyond recognizing shapes from how it looks to get into different other specific properties of the shapes. And even this task where they have to find the similarities and the differences between two shapes. So does anyone want to respond this for this task? Telling me the similarity and difference between...
How will students do this task? Perhaps if you want to speak about that, or if you want to speak about how would you use this task with the students? What will happen when you do this with the students? Anybody can unmute.
Hello.
Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, okay, I have a small doubt also that related to the same activity. Like when a child is making connections between the properties but not able to identify the necessary and sufficient properties. For example, for this child, the two shapes in the first column. Like if a child can identify that a triangle has three corners, then would go with the first one. But may not be able to understand that the edge of the line is also a corner in the second shape. There may be some confusion there. So I am a little... I would like to know what is it that in analysis they're connecting with the properties. I suppose if a child remembers that a triangle has three corners, then they'll go with the first shape. If they remember that a pentagon has five corners, they'll go with the second shape and parallelogram and so on. But then how would a child learn to identify that the corner of a line is also considered a corner? Or, you know, are we talking about these necessary and sufficient conditions when we're talking about that?
So actually one of the necessary condition could also be that it should be a closed shape to begin with. For introducing any polygon, it has to start with a closed shape, that it is a closed figure. and then right, moving ma'am. To the
ma'am,
other
so, but property. Then abhi analysis in the analysis stage of development, the student is not able to infer necessary and sufficient properties, right?
Yeah.
For the whole class. So maybe the student may not know that that's a closed polygon, like, you know, if whether a triangle is to be considered a polygon belonging to the class polygon.
True. So again, like for analysis level, we may not have to get into defining the shape. Like, so this is the next intermediary level, which requires a student to engage with shape at a different level. So for example, at the visualization level, they have those like general prototypes, which is also important to begin with. Like for very elementary children, it is not a good idea to start with a triangle is something which has three sides, three corners, it's a closed figure. So it is always good to start with the visualization level, because that would be more meaningful for a children to engage with. And then facilitating this level of engagement where they are kind of encouraged to describe more about the given shape, whether they can understand. It's okay if they can even recognize that the second shape is an open figure. It has three sides. So here we are not moving to define the triangle, but at least identify the different properties that a triangle might have.
Yeah. And
okay,
I would,
ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah. And I would say that this is a very, I mean, analysis level, what is important is to students to able to identify what are the important properties. And here, for example, in the shapes that are there, to be able to describe those properties itself. Because what happens usually in Indian mathematics classroom is students just memorize the definition of the different shapes. And once they have memorized the definition, it is considered as that they have understood. But what we are trying to say by developing these different activities is that there is a lot that a student needs to learn by observation of shapes, identifying their properties, identifying which properties remain constant, invariant in different, when you transform it in different ways, for example, increase in size or just slide it, and which properties change. So the properties which are remaining invariant, could they perhaps they could be sufficient properties. This is the kind of discussion that the teacher needs to have with the students, and it's not that they should just directly give the definition itself.
Yeah
Jine, so, go ahead.
So
thank
actually,
you ma'am.
Moving from recognizing, let's say, this third shape as a star to identifying that it has 10 sides or it has like 10 corners or things like that. So, and that also kind of facilitate their mathematical vocabulary, that from a general understanding of shape, that something looks like a star or some half pi or quarter pi, to moving to understanding that it is three quarter of a circle, or it has like two straight sides, it has one curved side. So facilitating that mathematical vocabulary, which kind of helps them to engage with the properties of the shapes, requires such kind of task or such kind of activities with the learner. Okay, so I will move to the next level. Next level of reasoning is the level where children or the learner actually abstract and do a bit of informal deduction. So at this level, they can also come up with some hypothesis or postulates or also predict some of the results. They can, like, for example, classify based on a given set of properties. Like, as I said, at the analysis level, they can just identify property. But here, they can also understand that if the opposite sides or opposite pair of sides are parallel or equal, then it is going to be the class of parallelogram, and rectangle can also be can also belong to the class. So all sort of things they can deduce, which is an informal deduction, but at this level they can do that. Then as I already said, and they can also to a great extent use definitions. But like this level also needs some kind of facilitation, and how do we help that? So maybe I will engage with this task. So for example, let's say we wanted to understand the class of shapes. So what do you think, like how do we represent the set of square in this set representation? If this is the set of quadrilaterals and inside that there is a set of rectangles, so how do we represent the set of squares in it? Maybe I will show.
Anybody off. Can unmute and speak? Which of the following options will?
Ma'am, I think option C, option three.
Why?
Okay. Ma'am, because squares are a kind of rectangles only, because in rectangles, opposite sides are equal and the angle is of 90 degree, while in the square, each and every side is equal. And again, the angle is 90 degree only.
Okay. So here also, I think what this definition and the necessary sufficient condition plays a big role. Like we had, like I remember in one of our session with the students, students just not were agreeing that a square is a rectangle. So they came up with lot of properties, lot of results to like argue that a square is not a rectangle. A square is something whose diagonals intersect at 90 degree. Rectangle doesn't have a property like that. So all sort of examples they came up with to like argue that a square is not a rectangle. So like so that this can also be a task for us and teachers to like how do we convince the student that a square will belong to the class of a rectangle?
So I think we should also ask teachers to just discuss and share how do they convince the students, because it would be interesting even for us to know.
Yeah.
Any teacher would like to speak? How do you convince a student that square is a rectangle?
Ma'am, when we teach them, we tell them that square is a special kind of rectangle. Okay, so what property is different in a square compared to a rectangle? If you see the sides, opposite sides are equal even in a square. The opposite angles, all the corner angles are 90 degree. The diagonals are of equal length. But only difference is in a rectangle, the opposite angles where the diagonals intersect, they are equal. And in a square, those angles are 90 degree. They bisect at 90 degree. So because there is something special that they are bisecting at 90 degree, we have given it a different name, that this is a special type of rectangle, which is called as a square.
Okay.
So,
Sangeeta Mishra, ma'am, would you also like to speak? She has posted on the chat, Jeenath. I don't know if you are able to see.
No, I can't see.
Okay, let me read it out. Sangeeta, ma'am, you want to speak? Sangeeta, ma'am, says that she first asks what are the properties of the rectangle and then check each property and compare it with the square.
Okay. So, but like there are many shapes or classes of shapes which may have common properties, but does that mean they belong to the same class? So, for example, I think there might be some common properties between a square and a parallelogram as well, or a square and quadrilateral as well. So, does that mean all of them are in the same class?
So Sangeeta ma'am is saying go one by one. Ma'am, you can unmute and we can have a discussion. Sangeeta ma'am? Okay, she's not unmuting. You go ahead, Jeannie. Yes, you want to respond to her?
No, not directly responding. Maybe we can discuss another example.
Ma'am, if we utilize the idea of symmetry in class in doing this, so a symmetric rectangle is basically a square, right? And what I'm thinking is, what if your student is even younger than the age where the properties can be given to the student in the kind of vocabulary that is needed? What if the student is, say a 7-year-old or an 8-year-old, just learning different shapes, because children at that age sometimes say, I like shapes, I want to learn more about them.
Yes.
So if we just show them about symmetry and try to show them that if you blow up a square, you turn it into a rectangle by stretching it over one direction. So a square can be turned into a rectangle and follow through by the virtue of not having the background of those, you know, as I said, those technical terms. Would that work?
Okay, maybe that work, but I'm not sure if that can create some more misconception and confusion among children that square can be like stretched or contracted to create another shape and they belong to the same class. So so like I think move like when we move to that property level, we can't go back to again the visualization level of reasoning to like oh, support okay. them from the visualization level. Yeah,
so if a student can visualize a geometric shape properly, then it is necessary for the child to progress on to the next level of geometric reasoning.
Yeah, so and as a teacher we need to support that. Like it is definitely the higher level of reasoning or engagement with geometric shapes than what they were doing at the visualization level.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah, yeah.
Ma'am, it is also possible to make a table and give it to them where we are giving them different shapes and we have questions like, are all the sides equal? Are only opposite sides equal? Are the diagonals equal? What is the measure of the corner angle? And after they have done the entire table, then we name the figures. That, okay, all these properties are there. So this is a rectangle. Okay, we have similar properties. So many 5-6 properties same. Only this one is different. So this we call it as a square. So maybe that may give a better understanding of the similarity and differences between the shapes.
Okay, okay. Yeah, it could be a really nice strategy to do it that way. So I would like to discuss another example. So I will move to this next example. So like the same task. So we have a quadrilateral and there is one set which is representing the parallelogram. So how do we represent the trapezium? And to complicate this matter further, I am going to give you three definitions of a trapezium. And so, and you have to tell me like, how will we represent the set of trapeziums if we follow definition one. So definition one is a trapezium is a quadrilateral with only one pair of sides parallel. Anyone wants to respond?
So it will be a superset of parallelogram.
It will be a superset of parallelogram. Does everyone agree to this? Like it will be a superset of parallelogram if we follow definition one.
Ma'am, shouldn't be a disjointed set, like completely no intersection. Because parallelograms are quadrilaterals with two sides parallel. Trapezium is a quadrilateral with only one side parallel. So they have no common point, no?
Okay. Yeah.
Using so, just the first definition.
Using the first definition. Okay. So
those who agree with him can type yes. Or Sangeeta Mishra says no.
So no for what? Like the first one where the trapezium will be superset of parallelogram or will it be a disjoint set?
I think, Jeannie, you need to number them. Like for the first one, say no. Or for the second one, say yes or no. Then they will be able to respond, I think, on chat.
Okay. Yeah. So, I'm since I'm not able to see the chat, I'm also getting a little bit confused. So so there are like two representations shared so far. Let's say the first representation is when the trapezium is a superset of parallelogram. So how many of you agree with the first representation? Say one, yes. And the second representation when the trapezium is a disjoint set. And this is like if we follow definition one. So
so many people are saying first is yes, and then for disjoint, I think they are saying no, but I'm not sure. There are people have responded. Only three people have responded. They can perhaps unmute. Yeah. Let's hear from people. That is better if I to get confused.
Any other way to represent it, maybe?
Yeah. Please unmute and speak.
If you follow the same logic of making tables and comparing the trapezium and parallelogram using the definition one, then according to that, it should not be disjoint because there are some common things which are there. So there is no common thing in the table, then it should be disjoint thing. But there is common, so it can't be a disjoint.
Okay. So rather now responding whether which representation is correct one, now I would want you to engage with definition two, which says a trapezium is a quadrilateral with at least one pair of sides parallel. So does any of you wanted to respond? How will the set of trapezium will look like if we follow definition one? So I want you to focus on the qualifier here. Like in the definition one, we said only one pair of sides parallel or exactly one pair of sides parallel. But in this case, we are saying at least one pair of sides parallel.
Ma'am, I have a doubt to clarify here. What are we considering a parallelogram's technical definition to be when we are comparing? Like, are we comparing with the whole corpus of knowledge we have about parallelograms, or are we sort of using the same thing? Like a similar definition of a parallelogram is a quadrilateral with two pairs of sides parallel. Are we assuming that to be the only thing we know about parallelogram or everything that we know?
See, this is in the context of students, like school students. So yes, we ask that following the definition of two pairs of parallel.
Okay, ma'am. So in that scenario, the first one should be a disjoint set. The second one should be a superset. Because parallelograms then become a special kind of a quadrilateral with more than one side parallel. So at least, so then there are other parallelograms also. So they'll be, you know, greater than equal to one is what we're talking about here, right?
Okay. So you are saying the parallelogram will be a superset of trapezium, or the set of trapezium will be a superset of parallelogram if we follow definition two?
Okay, ma'am. So parallelograms are quadrilaterals with exactly two pairs of sides parallel. So by the second definition, a trapezium is a quadrilateral with at least one pair of side parallels. So greater than equal to one will all fall under the category of the equal to two also falls under the category of greater than one. So trapezium becomes a larger set, okay. The superset.
Okay. So does everyone agree to what sir said right now, or is there any other response?
Ma'am, I'm not sir. I'm Akita. I'm a student at the college.
Oh, okay. It's fine. I was just, I don't know. Maybe...
Yeah.
Announcing you in it.
So it's okay. I mean, what do you all see? What do you all agree with the Akita? Those who agree with Akita, or I think there are Jasneet is saying that second definition, trapezium is a superset of parallelogram, and first set, the trapezium is disjoint set. And Kainat Sindhi is saying second is right. There is Sangeeta Mishra is saying second definition is right. Then what about others? Jeenath, you want to?
Yeah. Maybe I would like to summarize here now. So, I think now most of the responses are going in the right direction. So according to definition one, definitely the set of trapezium will be a disjoint set. And according to definition two, trapezium will be a superset for the set of parallelogram. And I think one of the teachers said that maybe definition two is correct because definition two is the definition we follow generally in our textbook. But what I wanted to highlight through this interaction or through this example is the definition is very crucial in understanding.
There is someone who is saying that definition one is correct. So what would you respond?
I'm not sure here. Maybe there are different textbooks and some textbook follow definition one and some textbook follow definition two. So, and based on the definition, we can conclude or understand these classes of shapes, like how they represent each other. So,
yeah. So, but is it okay to have multiple definitions, or there should be one standard definition all over the world? What do you all think? Is multiple definitions okay?
Ma'am, the second definition says a trapezium is a quadrilateral with at least one pair of sides parallel. Okay. So if one pair of sides is parallel, we call it as a trapezium. But if the other one is also parallel, then we'll call it as a parallelogram. No, when we have named it separately, see, trapezium name may have been given just because it has only one pair of sides parallel and not the other one.
Okay, so I think coming back to the same square and rectangle example, so there are also like the same confusion that a student can come up with, that why are we saying a square is also a rectangle? Like, we have a different name or a different class of shapes which are square. So why do we call a square as a rectangle? So I think it all boils down to the definition part, like how are we defining the necessary sufficient condition to define a rectangle, and if a square is following those two necessary sufficient condition, then that is the reason a square is also a rectangle. But of course not the other way around, because rectangle doesn't follow the necessary sufficient condition to be a square. So okay,
Akita has raised his hand.
Yeah.
Akita, we want to speak. So, Chetan Kumar is saying that parallelogram is parallelogram isosceles trapezium. Go ahead, Akita.
Ma'am, so theoretically speaking, a child may only have this confusion if we have lent to the child a problematic sufficient condition, right? Like, if we tell a child that a rectangle has to have two sides of two different lengths, only then a child would get confused, right? Otherwise, if we never go there, the child will always think that a rectangle is a technically a parallelogram with right angles. So that means a square automatically becomes a rectangle as well.
Even if you don't tell that to the child, what happens is that students, what they see, based on that, they form their conceptions. So, and it is not that we always show them a square. It has to have different types of rectangles also as an example, right? So this will happen on its own, whether we tell them this or not. And that is my view.
Okay, ma'am.
Jeannie, what do you think?
I also think, so that's why this level is hierarchically is like at, like above the level of analysis, where they're not just recognizing the properties, but based on these properties, they're also trying to understand the necessary sufficient condition for which a class of shapes is defined. So I think this at this level, we also need to engage in this kind of conversation where they can understand the necessary and sufficient condition for a class of shapes. So, and I think with proper such kind of exposure, they themselves will be able to come up with these informal deductions that the class of a square belongs to the class of rectangle, or the class of rectangle is a superset of a class of a square. So yeah, I would respond.
I think we should now move ahead, Jeannie.
Yeah.
The time, looking at time.
Right. So the fourth level of Van Hill geometric reasoning is the formal deduction, which generally in the school curriculum, students come across, I think in standard 8 or 9, where they are just bombarded with a lot of theorems and without many times like spending a lot of time in the level of analysis and the level of informal deduction or abstraction. So, but like to actually engage with theorem or formal deduction also, one needs to go through all these levels. For example, at this level, students were able to recognize or understand the definition, understand the terms, undefined terms, understand axioms, theorems, or the statement of a theorem and the converse of the statement. They're also able to construct their original proofs. So at this level, a student may be able to prove that some of the angles of a triangle is 180 degree, or in a triangle, side opposite the largest angle is longest, or in a square the or in a parallelogram the opposite angles are equal, all such kind of things they will be able to deduce at this level with like formal like the formal steps. So and this is the level which we kind of expect children or learner to attain through school geometry, but we expect that without giving or without facilitating the other level. So we need to constantly work even in developing the other two levels. Okay, so I will now move to a question which we extensively used in our baseline and our diagnostic test. So, and this we, the same test we did in Rajasthan, Chhattisgarh, Mizoram. And what do you think student like might have chosen the response as? What do you think is the most selected response for a square? Does anyone want to?
You can type in chat. You can unmute if you want to. B. Most people are responding B. Okay. A. Kainat Sindhi is saying A.
Okay. So why B?
Yes. Why B? You can unmute. Now everyone is saying A.
Okay.
We are asking about students' response. What do you think is the most common response given by students? And this was done by ninth standard. So many people feel it would be A.
Ma'am, again, here the reason is same, that while teaching them, while doing proofs and all, the way the B square is drawn, we always draw it in this position.
Yeah.
Hmm. So when they look at A, it looks more like a kite to them than a square.
Right.
They don't focus on the size of the sides.
Yeah, the ma'am, length of the sides. Actually, you have said it like the right thing in a way. Like most of the results which we found, many of the students or majority of students selected B as the correct answer, and very few students selected A as their as the correct answer. Okay.
So the correct answer is A, but most of them select B.
Most of them selected B as their correct answer. So, and why selected B? So we can like through, if we see it from the Van Hill lens, so we can understand they are reasoning at the visualization level. That's what is it, or which shape looks like a square more than anything else. So from that reasoning, they end up choosing B as the correct answer. But the moment they engage with the property terms, and some of the students who are to some extent at the analysis level and know that a square is something which has a 90 degree angle and has sides equal, so some of them end up choosing C and D as their correct answer. But they again are still at the analysis level, that they can identify the property, but they don't know the necessary and sufficient condition for a shape to be a square. So only when children reach level 3 of Van Hill, they can understand the square is something which has all the angles equal and all the sides equal. So, okay, so.
So Kaushal Yadav, do you want to speak? You have raised your hand. You can unmute.
Yes, madam, I have one question over here, or one observation which I can say. So by conducting this type of diagnostic test in the classroom, can we also find out at which level of Van Hills students are, finding difficulty? Can we find out like that? So because that can give a great impact to our teaching also.
Yes, ma'am. You can do that. And you very clearly pointed out that this will give you an idea that at what level students are and how we can facilitate them to move to the higher level of Van Hill reasoning. You can definitely try such kind of thing in class or,
So in fact, on Van Healy, there are even suggestions that you, this, there are several questions and activities which can be used for diagnostic test. And once you find out what the level is of the students, there are also activities suggested to push students towards a higher level. from the lower level itself. And you will be able to find this in our handbook to some extent. And we have also addressed that in one of the course that we have made on reflective mathematics teaching. It's for in-service teachers. We might again open it up in June, in which we deal with these ideas quite extensively. Yeah. Okay. Dini, go ahead, please.
Yes. Thank you.
So, yeah. So as I already said, that student who have selected B as the correct answer might be at level one of Van Hill, where they're reasoning at the level of visualization. Student who might have selected option C and D were at the level of analysis. The student who might have selected A might have reached the level of abstraction where they can recognize clearly that it has all the sides equal and all the angles 90 degree. But apart from that, we have also thought of level four reasoning also here to a great extent, where they can also like do some bit of formal deduction. So far we have learned the necessary and sufficient condition for a shape to be a square is all the sides equal and all the angles equal. But can we make this definition more like more shorter, in the sense, do we actually need to check all the angles to be 90 degree? Is it enough to define a square as something which has all the sides equal and only one angle as 90 degree? And can we prove that this will also like will give a square or this can also be a universal definition for a square? And the other way around, like if all the angles are 90 degree and at least one pair of side is equal, or the adjacent pair is equal, maybe one pair of side is equal is not enough, because maybe in that case there won't be a square.
So mostly
move to
No, I was just saying that mostly when we talk about square and when students think about square, L3, this is the definition that they are thinking most of the time, that all sides are equal and all angles are 90 degree. But this might be necessary, but like, is it sufficient? Like, to what is the sufficient? What is the minimum criteria that should be there that we will get a square? So for that, if we see, then if all the sides are equal, and even if one angle is 90 degree, it will form a square. Now, these kind of discussion also, if we are able to do with students, then they will be able to identify the minimal criteria that one needs to be able to get a square itself. Because if it is not 90 degree, it might, and all sides are equal, it may become kite also, right? But only if it is all sides equal in 90 degree. Even if one angle is 90 degree, then ultimately on its own, other angles will also become 90 degree, because all sides are equal. So this is the kind of logic that people, students have to do. And if they are able to understand this, then they are at level four. Yeah.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
And I would like to, like all the participants also to try this and like actually try to prove it mathematically, that whether it will be correct for all the cases, whether they can like deductively prove it, like this statement. Okay, so I will move to the next part because I may have to finish. So the last level is the level of rigor, where children can reason not only from the Euclidean geometry, but even non-Euclidean planes, like the Earth's surface, where a triangle can also have 290 degrees. But generally, we don't come across this level at the school geometry. So we like we can engage with it later, but not here. Okay. So to summarize, these are the five Van Hill levels of reasoning, and we also engage with some of the examples and how we can facilitate those levels of reasoning. So now moving to, I don't have much time, maybe another 5 minutes. So I will just rush to this. So these are these are the pedagogical pillars that we follow while teaching geometry, that in the class there should be kind of peer discussion and collaborative learning. We believe that learners learn from their mistakes. So there should be a safe space for children to do mistakes. And there should be authentic and relevant learning experiences in the classroom, where children on their own construct their own designs and have their own hypothesis or have their own conjectures. So these are some glimpses of that. Okay. Some more components that we followed while designing different activities of GR is, as initially also one of the ma'am said, ki including non-conventional shapes, task which kind of allow children to engage with geometric properties of the shape, engage in deductive reasoning, letting them play collaboratively. And as I already said, sometimes even the game context can encourage children to make mistakes, and it also opens a very fertile ground of learning opportunities. And we also use different tools to support learner to move to higher levels of reasoning.
Zainab ma'am, you wanted to ask something? You had raised hand.
Ma'am, related to that, only the definition where a square has all sides equal and one angle 90, as a definition, is that sufficient without saying that opposite sides are parallel?
Okay. So,
ma'am, you have to think about it, that if all sides are equal and if just one angle is 90 degree, would it mean that the two sides will become parallel on its own or not? Or you, I mean, this is something for you to think. Yeah.
Or you can come up with a counter example to disapprove that this definition may not work. So, for that also you need to like construct a shape which kind of like follows this property, but it's not a square. So, yeah, it's a task. Somebody's saying something.
I think they unmuted by mistake. I'll handle this, Jeenie. You go ahead.
Okay. So, yeah. So, as I said, like, we have developed the police squad game, and we followed all the kind of components which I just now shared. So, we also had a story and context to encourage students to engage with the logic of the game. And since it is a game, to allow a student to make mistakes and learn from their mistakes. So I will briefly introduce this first mission of the game. So where there will be a set of shapes given to students, or will come on the screen. And I may not have much time. So anybody would wanted to respond that if we follow these four clues, which will be the possible shape? So generally the storyline is like, there are a set of aliens, all of them look same. The only distinct feature is the shape mark on their chest. And for a crime, a set of alien were captured. But among these set, only one is the actual culprit. And we have to identify which is the culprit based on these four clues. So in the game, you can get multiple clues. I will at the end maybe show the game. I don't know if I have much time to engage with.
Jeenie, don't worry. I think we'll do this and then I'll show the geometric reasoning module itself after playing this round. Yeah. Okay. Would that be fine?
Yeah.
Yeah. So what do you all think? How would you respond? These are the clues given here. Based on these clues, which shape do you think is the culprit?
If I kind of number them like 1, 2, 3 at the top and 4, 5, 6 at the bottom. So which do you think will be the culprit?
People are saying 5, 3. You can also unmute, please. That would be better.
Yeah, and explain why 5 or why 3.
Anyone? They are saying 3.
Can I speak in Hindi?
Yeah, sure. Please go ahead.
Okay. Because of क्यों 5 है? Because last 4 point लिखा था कि exactly 6 होना चाहिए sides उसकी. तो ये 5 number का है, उसमें exactly 6 sizes है. और बस ये main reason था. और first लिखा था कि बस ये one reason.
Okay. Yeah. So, ma'am, आपने बहुत ही मतलब shortcut में ये कर लिया है. Generally, when the game screen appears, these clues appear one by one. So, and like the logic of the game is that we eliminate the non-culprit one. So based on the first clue that it has less than two right angles, we kind of eliminate the first one, that this one has a right angle, so it cannot be the culprit. So the game is played that way. Maybe when Ruchi will be showing the module or the platform, you can show the game. Like actually one by one the clue appear. So
we have
to eliminate the one which are not culprit and then ultimately find the culprit. But your reasoning is also perfectly fine here because the clues don't appear one by one here. I have just listed down the clues.
But that is a very good strategy, no? She identified the most important clue and based on that she was able to zero it down. So I think that's a very good strategy.
थैंक यू मैम. नहीं मैम, दूसरा और चौथा ये दो नंबर से हम लोग को पता चलता है कि फिफ्थ वाला एकदम करेक्ट है, सेकंड एंड फोर्थ.
सो यही स्किल हमें बच्चों में डेवलप करना है इसके. सो जीनी, शुड आई शेयर द स्क्रीन एंड शो?
यस,
आई हैव ओपन्ड इट ऑन माय लैपटॉप.
ओके,
सो आई विल जस्ट शेयर दिस. So this is the website of CLICS, Open Educational Resource. So you just have to type clicsoer.tis.edu. Jeannie, can you just type that on the chat so that people can just see? So when you go there, you will see these are all different modules that we have developed. And in this, you see Geometric Reasoning Part 1 and Geometric Reasoning Part 2. So what you have to do is click, if you want to explore it online, if you have internet facility, you can just click on this rocket icon and you will be able to explore module online. If you click on this cloud with a downward arrow icon, you can download it offline for in your laptop and can play it later without internet also. So when you click on this rocket icon, you will come to this kind of page. Geometric Reasoning Part 1. Here, as you can see, we have tried to include all three different languages, English, Hindi, and Telugu. And if you want to change the language to Hindi, you can change it here to click on it, it will change into Hindi, or click on this, it will change into Telugu. So I'll just change it back to English. Okay. And if you click on here, show more, you can see student handbook also available and teacher handbook is also available. Then these are the different units that we have developed. I'll just show you in unit 2, we have this police squad game, which Zenith was showing it, a different version of that. And this game has four missions, four different levels. Here we have even given a help video for you to make you understand how to play the game itself. If you see this screen, this square police squad, all you have to do is to just click on it. It takes a little bit of time to load for the first time when you're starting it on your computer. But once it loads, it will be easier in the next time. So I have closed the voice because it distracts a bit. Just wait. So you have to click on this, hit start. Then there is a story here. Just one sec. So this is the story. So this is an alien which has come from a different planet and they ask him how they escape, and they were able to escape due to their reasoning capabilities. And then this one is given a job in police to find out who has done all these crimes. So these are the four different missions. If the first is the crystal case where the crystals were stolen and he has to identify who is the culprit. And here we go. So these are the different shapes that are there on the different people who have been jailed, different aliens who have been jailed. Some might be innocent, and you have to find out which one is the culprit based on the clues which are appearing here. So we have to click on the clue here. So the first clue is culprit has more than four straight strides. So which one would you say? So which based on this clue, which shape can be released? What do you think? Which shape can be released? Oh, chat. Some people are saying two. Some people are saying one. Two, three. So it has got more than straight side. Jeannie, you want to also continue along with talk? Because I'm handling the controls. Can you talk? Yeah. Some people are saying one.
Yeah. Only one person had said one so
far. Yeah.
Yeah, initially also one person had said one.
Two can be released, one. See, what is the clue here? Culprit has more than four straight strides. So it has to be more than four straight strides. So this two has only four. Right?
Yeah.
So therefore, you feel it can be released. Right?
Somebody is saying four. Somebody is saying one and two.
Hmm. Dinak, you do the discussion.
Yeah. I was thinking if somebody also wanted to say, why are you choosing that particular shape to be released? So the logic is to eliminate the one which don't follow the clue, because Zainab, they are not the culprit.
Yeah. Zainab.
Yeah. Ma'am, it says the culprit has more than four straight sides. So only second one has four sides. All the remaining are more than four. So one of the remaining three is the culprit, and second one cannot be the culprit. The first figure has five sides.
Right. So are you suggesting that we can release the second one?
We can release the second one.
Okay.
So I'll click on this and then I'll click release. Now I'll have to click on the clue. The clue is culprit has more than three equal pairs of sides. Now, which one is the innocent and which one could be the culprit?
Or which one, we can release it this. Okay, somebody is suggesting one. Okay, but can you also tell the reason? Are you saying one to be released or one is to be kept and the other two shapes has to be released?
One can be released.
Okay. Can you explain the reason why one is to be released?
Because third and fourth has four equal pairs of sides, like three on the top and one at the bottom.
Okay.
So now we go to the next clue. There are no more clues.
Both are same.
So, done.
There may be some technical error, I feel.
This is some error is coming. I don't know why.
Same set of shapes generally don't come. Like we have all separate set of shapes that appear.
Yeah. So let's try one more. Yeah. The culprit has less than six straight sides. Which one can be released on that basis?
Three. Somebody is saying three.
Why? Chalo, we'll release it. We don't have much time to discuss. Okay. Let's go for the next clue. We also have these tools here. Equal sides, parallel lines, right angle. The culprit has exactly two equal pairs of sides. Which one can be released on the basis of this?
One and two, one. Everyone is saying one.
One.
Yeah. Would you like to use the equal pair tool for the last shape also? Because in fact, I'm getting confused that if it has two.
Okay. Equal. So.
Okay. So they are right. Okay. So both.
This one not applicable.
Yeah. This also has two equal pair of sets. So maybe only one.
Yeah, yeah.
Somebody is saying one and four also, but maybe they were also at the same confusion.
Yeah, perhaps. Yes. In some way, they look a bit similar, but they are not.
Yeah.
In these two sides are equal, and these two sides are equal. Yeah. So which one do you want me to release?
One. Four. Okay, still somebody is confused.
So I have to click this again. Then release. Culprit has at least five straight sides.
Which one to be released? Suggest the shape which has to be released. Okay, four. Now everyone is on the same side.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Say two also.
Okay. The culprit has at least five straight sides. So we don't release the culprit. We have to keep the culprit back. In the jail itself, we can only release the innocent.
Yeah.
Okay. So now we'll see. Yeah. So it says fabulous work. You have caught the culprit. And then it will show you what were the properties that you had matched correctly and what was the score that you have got. So I think that's all for now because we have extended the time. You can go and explore other missions on the CLICSOER also. Right now, if you have any questions about this, please do ask Zeenath. And I will also post a feedback form for you to respond. And please do remember to respond to the feedback form because it is important for us. So any questions you want to ask? Zeenath, do you have questions?
No, ma'am, that is previously I had raised.
Okay, you can lower it. Anybody else wants to ask any question? I'll just post the feedback form link.
On the chat, there is some question by Tarun Chaudhary, I think. Can you please level 2, level 3 by rectangle and square example? I'm not clear what is your question. Would you like to speak? Can you elaborate on your question? It is not very clear from what you have written on chat. Tarun Chaudhary, would you like to say your question? Okay, maybe I will move to the next question. So Jenna is asking, does this site requires any registration? No, so it doesn't require any registration. You can explore without logging in. Okay. Can we get the recording of this meeting? I think yes.
Yes.
There is a YouTube link which can be shared, I think, later.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
You can get the recording. I'll show you in just a few minutes where we upload all our recordings. There. So this is the... I have just now posted the link for the feedback form. Please do fill it up. And in the meanwhile, I'll also post the link of the YouTube channel where all the School Synergy recordings are uploaded once we have made them. So it takes around 2 to 3 weeks for a particular sessions to get released on YouTube. But we do release it. Okay. Yeah. So this is the YouTube link. And let me also share. So if you can see my screen, if you want to be aware of the different events that we have been organizing, and the future synergy events that would be there, the recordings or intimation, please do follow us on these different social media handles, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn, or YouTube. You can note them and you can just follow us so that whenever next synergy meeting is there, you are able to get intimated about it. We also email all the participants who register for any of the synergy workshop that whenever we have the next session. So I think you will also get an email, but it is good to follow the social media handles so that you are aware. I hope you have responded to the feedback form. Let me check. Only 4 responses have come till now. I would just request others also to please fill the feedback form, please. I have put the link in the chat. And if there are any further questions that you want to ask us about geometric reasoning module, about geometric reasoning, we can answer that. Thank you, Vandana ma'am. Thanks a lot. See, we are doing this for the purpose that it is able to provide some sort of good resources for teachers to use in the classroom. It is useful. But if we don't get feedback, we do not get an idea of whether, any of these things were useful to you. Were they relevant? If there are any further changes that are required in the way we conduct the session itself, the timing of the session, if there are any topics that interest you, which you would like to see. So all this is there in the feedback form, and we would be really happy if you respond to that feedback form. This is all that we ask of you after attending this. In fact, what we are thinking is that starting March, if people are continuously joining these synergy sessions for mathematics, then if they do that for a period of 10 sessions, 10 math sessions or so, then perhaps they can get some sort of certificate for that. Till now, we have not been giving any certificate for attending the synergy sessions, but we are thinking of starting some sort of continuous maths-based or English-based sessions for which people can get a certificate after doing 10 sessions, so that it gets recorded somewhere that they have done 10 hours of professional development engagement in form of these workshops. Do let us know if you will be interested in this kind of activity, because it would be difficult for us to sustain it if many people do not join it. Thank you, Sangeeta ma'am, for indicating your interest. If there are others also, you can please let us know, because if more people are interested, it will be useful for us to sustain it. Otherwise, this one-off workshops, like we do just one workshop and then we expect that people will be able to do it in the classroom, is something difficult. And we have also seen that teachers, in fact, they need some sort of continuous engagement. They need to try out these ideas in their classrooms, get back and talk about it, what kind of challenges that they faced with students, something new they found working with students. So all these ideas need discussion, and perhaps these kind of meetings can become that kind of space for discussion, where it's not just one person is presenting ideas, but the ideas are also coming from teachers. And they are also sharing the kind of things that they are doing in the classrooms. And we are also learning from that. Thanks, Shravanti. Thanks, Ujwal Banerjee, for indicating your interest. Please conduct workshop on fractions, decimals, ratio, proportions, percentage. Yes, we are interested, especially in fractions and decimals. We already were thinking ratio and proportions also we were thinking. Yeah. Thank you, Zainab ma'am. Srinivas, thank you, Srinivas sir. Thank you, Jyoti, Sanan ma'am.
Thank you so much for the session, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Akita, for interacting so much.
It makes
the session so much lively for us.
Thank you so much for having us. Yeah. Thank you.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Go ahead.
So request a session on the topic of mathematization. Actually, I have done that geometric reasoning course and I'm waiting for the result. But in unit 3, we were exposed to many new vocabulary terms, which I was not aware of. So
okay.
Just plan to conduct a session on this.
Unit 3 itself? Okay, we will. Yes.
Ideas in mathematization. So I understood all the videos that were shown, but some vocabulary terms
were difficult.
Were new.
Yes. Okay, so we can think of that also. Based on unit 3 also, maybe we can have a session. Zenith, if you can make a note of it somewhere, the topics that people are suggesting.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you, Jyoti ma'am. So if you have given us the feedback and have indicated your interest and the topics you're interested in, you can log out if you want. Shravanti, thank you for indicating your interest. I'll be saving the chat so I will know who all would be interested. Those who have filled up the feedback form and have indicated interest, they can leave if they want. We'll be ending the meeting soon. I'm just holding on so that if somebody wants the link on the chat for filling up the feedback form, they are able to get that, because if I end the meeting, they will not be able to access it. I'm stopping the recording now.